see it. There it is. Guess we'll edit this. All right, so we are actually live. Live on YouTube. So, as I said, lab is just an extension of lecture. We're going to do lecture here in the lab. And I did mean to say, too, I'm going to probably get seat assignments on Wednesday. So if you're comfortable with those seats, that's fine. You guys will have a hard time because I'll be in the way and the screen gets blocked, but we can work with it. And that's just in case we have contact tracing that needs to take place. I can look up to see, you know, if Louise is like, hey, yeah, I'm positive. I know who's sitting around him, and they can contact him. So we'll probably do that on Wednesday. All right, so what we're going to do this afternoon is just kind of go through the intro lecture and possibly start with R. All right, so again, I thought I had everything set up. I had to mess around with it. So what is biometry? All right, biometry is from the roots metros and bios, so the measure of life. That's essentially what it is. Now, that's a good generic term. What if we wanted a more specific term? Well, perhaps we could say that biometry is the application of statistical methods to the solution of biological problems. Now, in other words, we're trying to use statistics to either explain or detect. Explain or detect differences that hopefully helps us answer questions. I'm just going to emphasize statistical methods. This is math. That's what we're doing. We're going to look at probabilities to see, you know, how likely is it to actually see the data under various assumptions. If it's very unlikely, well then, yeah, maybe our assumptions are wrong. Or maybe we can conclude that a biological process is at work. Biometry has the synonyms biostatistics, biological statistics, and so forth. They all mean the same thing. We're using statistical methods to address biological problems. Now, what's statistics? We haven't really defined that. It's a scientific study of data describing natural variation. That's what it is. Statistics is all about trying to describe the natural variation that's out there, the natural randomness. All right, I take a ball and I bounce it. That ball is going to bounce at different heights depending on all of the variables at work. So air, you know, how much wind do we have? You know, is there any sort of movement in the ball? So perhaps maybe temperature of the ball relative to the outside and so forth. It's all leading to natural variation. And as you'll see, our goal is to try to control for this natural variation or account for it in some way, because everything else that is not natural variation may be variation due to our own control, the researcher control. Statistics also includes all of these aspects, so planning, collection, organization, analysis, and presentation of data. What we're going to focus on is really making sure that your data would be organized, so that we can then proceed with the analysis, and we will have some of the presentation. Now, the presentation is presenting it as a figure, as tables, and so forth. We're not going to do a whole lot about making these figures in R. That could be a class in and of itself, but we will make figures. We'll show how to add some error bars as we have write-ups of our individual problems, and that comes later on in the course. Statistics also has this interesting thing, is that it can mean it has another definition, and that's any sort of computed term or computed or estimated quantity. So like an average, that's a statistic. The variance, that's a statistic. All right. So it could get confusing depending on how you use statistics, but hopefully the context in which it's used allows us to determine, are we talking about one of these computed or estimated values, or are we talking about the actual field where we're describing natural variation? All right, scientific study, What is that? It should be a completely objective study aimed at solving some problem. So some problem at hand. It could be, you know, biological, it could be chemical in nature, it could be psychological. It all just kind of depends on what you're interested in. All right. Based on that problem, what you're trying to solve, that determines how we're going to design, analyze, interpret, and present our data. All right, so you can't just say, well, I want to use an ANOVA, and then come up with a question that allows you to use it. What you're doing is come up with a question and say, based on this question, what kind of data do I... So usually we work backwards. So what's my question? What kind of test would allow me to answer that question? And then how do I collect the data that would allow me to run the test? That could be ideal. But then we also have to look at it as saying, okay, this is what we want to do. We collect our data, but then as we start checking the assumptions, we find out, I can't run that test that I want to do because I violated my assumptions, so let's choose something else, some other test that allows me to answer this question. Data. Data is quantities of information. All right. It could consist of measurements. It could consist of counts. It could be qualitative in nature. It could be quantitative in nature. That's just information. That's what our data is. Now, I will point out that data is the plural form. If we refer to a single data point, that would be datum, which would be that single measurement variable, or single measurement of one variable. And we'll get into some variable terms for the variance, or for, the various terms for variables and so forth. Now, we use natural variation, and hopefully I kind of explained it, but as our definition says, it's anything that can happen in nature that's not under our control. All right? Anything that can happen that's not under the control. So, you know, we like to have repeatability. Maybe, you know, you make an omelet, and it is just absolutely great today. You're like, I'm going to make the same thing tomorrow. And you do, and it's different. It's like I weighed everything out. I had the exact same everything, but it all came out different. Well, that's due to natural variations, things beyond our control. All right. Maybe the Earth shifted in its orbit slightly and it changed the boiling point. Who knows? That's all natural variation. Fortunately for us, that natural variation usually follows probability theory, and that allows us then to use math to address some of these questions. Do you have to really know all of this probability theory? No. What we present is what I expect you to know. And we'll kind of take it a little bit slow. If you have the probability and stats course over at the math department, you'll go a little bit more into depth on these probability theories. All right. So where did biometry come from? Biometry has been along, or I should say statistics has been around for a long time. It actually has its foundations in political arithmetic. Right? And that's based on the roots of the word. With Latin status, Italian statista, which is all about the political state. Statistics came about as a way for the landowners, the dukes, the earls, the kings, to know and quantify the people that are living in their domain. All right? They wanted to know what percentage of individuals are male, what percentage... you know, are certain ages and so forth. So statistics kind of came out as basically a descriptor of the populations. And then statistics kind of expanded into game theory. I mean, games have been around for a long time, right? Rolling dice. Right? So people started saying, okay, if I'm going to play this game and I'm going to play it for money, how do I describe the outcomes to best give myself a chance to win or increase my chances of winning? All right, so then from this descriptive nature, they started looking at probability theories and started creating different probability distributions. Now, from this, they started including descriptive statistics with it in the sense of average outcomes. So on average, if I roll two dice, all right, I'm going to average, the average roll is a 7. All right, that's good to know because if we're playing against each other and we're like, we're going to play dice, you pick a number, I pick a number, and whoever's closer wins, If I know your favorite number is 3 and you keep saying, well, I'm going to pick 3, what do? I'm going to pick 7. Average roll, most frequent roll is going to be 7. All right? So game theory kind of developed, and it was all about, hey, if you risk money, I want to win it. The astronomers came next. So you can kind of go back to ancient Greeks. All right? That's the Minoans, you can say. On the island in the Mediterranean, right? They were all doing this, and then as we expanded, you've got the game theory, and then the astronomers come a little bit later. Now with the astronomers, they're taking a lot of their observations, some of their measurements, and trying to put it together in theories, coherent theories, you could say. They're trying to formalize the field. Important one is this, Carl Gauss. He recognized that measurements all had errors to them. And you, I'm sure you'll do it. You've experienced it in any of the labs. If you're supposed to measure something, right, we're all measuring the same thing, we're going to have variation with that. Well, Carl Gauss tried to use these errors to come up with averages. Okay, even if we account for errors, I expect to get an average between these ranges. From that, it led him to develop the least squares method of model fitting. So basically trying to fit a best fit line to all these different data points. If you've worked in Excel and made a graph, you've probably added trend lines. That's Carl Gauss. And it kind of came from trying to take these observations, these errors, and account for them. Minimize our errors based on some formula. A little bit later, you have this guy, Belgian astronomer, and I butchered his name numerous times. I'm not going to say it. This guy was known because he came up with this concept of the average man. He wasn't just interested in stats, wasn't just interested in biology. He was interested in medicine, too, and sociology. And with the average man, what he's noticing is that you have individual variation. Each of us is different. Right? Each of our heights are different. But as we start increasing our sample sizes, the averages start to condense on the actual true average. The variance converges on the true variance of the population. And that's where he says, you've got this average, and you've got everyone around there, but as I take samples, the larger the samples, the closer I'm going to be to that actual true average. With this idea, he then kind of developed this notion of statistical variation in distributions. Larger samples, we start to converge. And that's kind of where we come up with your normal curve, which was basically described by this guy, by Carl Gauss. Francis Galton added to that, because now he started throwing in the real biology aspect of it. All right, so take statistical theory, added it to biological variation, and now we're talking about variation in finger lengths, variation in toe lengths, and so forth. And with him, as he's measuring variation, he said that, well, this quote is attributed to him, whenever you can, count. It means if the data's there to collect, collect it. You never know when you're going to use it. Now, he applied statistical theory to the biological variation and developed regression methods, so regression analysis and correlation. So if you've got lengths of wheat, of a leaf, it's going to be correlated to the widths of the leaves. Now, you've got some really high correlations, you've got some low correlations, but this is Francis Galton. He's known as the father of biometry and, unfortunately, also the father of eugenics. What are eugenics?
The idea that there is a superior race based on genetics, or a superior gene combination based on genetics.
Yep. This idea that you can basically breed, you know, the perfect race of humans. Yeah, unfortunately. It's scattered throughout history. So that's the 19th century. Moving into the 20th century, we've got a couple big names. Carl Pearson, Ronald Fisher. All right, Carl Pearson, you probably have heard of his name because of things that were developed by him. Pearson's correlation, Pearson's chi-square. Standard deviations. This is Carl Pearson. All right. Most of his work, his mathematical work, was descriptive in nature, correlational in nature. right? And we'll hopefully we learn the chi-square. Ronald Fisher is big in both statistics and biology. All right, so Fisher, you've run across, some of you I know have run across his name. You've probably run across his name in the intro lectures. You've probably heard it in, I know you hear it in ecology. But he really focused on Mendelian inheritance based on variation. Talked about why, you know, populations have approximately equal proportion of male and females, right? Using probability theory to address that. He came up with many mathematical equations in evolution, including quite a few on population genetics. So those of you that had ecology should remember that we had a theory where Ronald Fisher went back and forth with the guy that developed this theory, shifting balance theory. I mean, they were going back and forth in the literature, arguing why their way is best. But things you might not have known is that this Ronald Fisher, in addition to doing things in biology, also came up with an analysis of variance, ANOVAs. Talked about likelihood methods or randomization methods. P-values is attributed to him. Fisher's exact test, it's a kind of an independence test, or test of independence, multiple regression. And this is just a list that I added because we'll probably encounter these. You'll see these again. So Fisher is a pretty big name in both biology and statistics. And then we can add on individuals as we progress further. And of course, as we come to modern time, we have the advent of computers. And with computers, we've got a lot more computing power, a lot more power to do complex analysis, including these randomization methods. Right? No longer do we have to actually sit there with a deck of cards randomizing our samples. We can do the randomization snap of a finger in R. And we'll actually do that. I'll show you those. So biometry today, broad, it's an active field. People are still working on it. Some applications, new applications are being developed. New techniques are being developed. I would say a lot of those are tied to genetics. You know, either phylogenies or predicting evolutions. Because as our ability to sequence large sections of the genome easily and cheaply now has a need for a way to analyze those data. All right, that seems to be where the field has been going. But we also have validation of older methods. Through randomization techniques, we can kind of go back and say, hey, how good does ANOVA do on certain types of data set? How good is a chi-square test with these types of data? What happens if we violate assumptions? You know, how big of a mistake is it? So you're seeing in the last 20, 30 years, you're seeing a lot of the validations, and that's partly why we still teach t-tests and ANOVAs, is that they've been validated multiple times. That even if you violate, you know, have a slight violation in assumptions, it's not really going to change some of our conclusions enough. All right. So when we work with statistics, there's kind of two different ways that people think. One is a deterministic way of thinking, or the other way is a probabilistic way of thinking. And this also ties into biology. So some people think that biology is already preset, that if you do this, then you will have this happen. All right, and maybe they start saying, with each new discovery, you add in that factor to say, okay, well, as we account for all of these, if we do this, then this should develop. You've got the other people that say, you know, I don't necessarily need to know everything. I can say, if I do this, then I have this probability that this will occur and this probability of that occurring. Is one way better than the other? No, because both of them are trying to do this. They're trying to define the uncertainty, to discover the uncertainty, or in some cases, try to control the uncertainty so that they can understand that end result. And a lot of times for us, we're creating an experiment where we've got two different treatments. We want to know, is there a difference in those treatments or not? So whether we take the deterministic approach or the probabilistic approach, we're both trying to quantify these uncertainties. Now, as we quantify these uncertainties, some cases, you really have to get into the math. Other cases, it's pretty clear cut. So as I was going through school, I encountered groups of people that took this, what I call the eyeball approach. So they collect their data, calculated averages, and so forth, and then they make their graph, and they say, look, if the two values look different, then they are different. And they leave it at that. They say, yeah, I don't have to do any stats. I think the argument against that is occasionally you have a lot of variation. You have something that varies a lot. So just because we collected the data today and we see that big difference doesn't mean that difference will persist tomorrow or the day after. If we do it, something changes. However, this approach is really useful for these all or nothing events. So if you're studying knockouts, you know, gene expression, you know, if you're going to try to knock out a gene, it's either it worked or it didn't work, right? So if you set up to, you know, you submit some messenger RNA to try to block a transcription process, if you don't see translation, hey, it worked. That's an all or nothing type of thing. In which case, the eyeball approach can work. It's either there or it's not. Most other cases, like in ecology or some other fields, we actually need that statistical approach because you have all that variation. All right. You look at it and you say, oh man, I can't tell because they're close and you've got error bars that are close. So what do we need to do then? Well, now we need to account for our variation that's on us, that's that treatment effect. We have to account for the natural variation, that's going to be all of our unexplained variation. And then once we account for that, is it likely that that difference is due to our effect? Yes or no? Is one, the eyeball approach versus statistical approach, is one better than the other? I'm going to say it depends on what you're studying. Depends on the experiment. You don't need a t-test to show me that a strain of bacteria is antibiotic resistant. It's either resistant or it's not. I don't need a t-test to show me that. That's the eyeball approach. But if you're going to tell me that a leaf that differs by 1 centimeter in length represents a new species, you're going to have to show me the stats. You're going to have to show me the consistency. All right, so why study biometry? Well, other than the fact that you're all in here and probably need the credit for some reason, all right, why would you get a PhD in statistics? And specifically biostats. Well, biology isn't deterministic. Those of you that had ecology, and I know at least one had ecology. All right, two had ecology. One of the key points for ecology is that contingency happens, right? We're unable to control for every single variable. So I can set up a fish tank, two fish tanks. There's no way they're going to be identical. Just because of different starting conditions. That's biology. It's not deterministic. All right? So statistics allows us to control for that variation. Number two, biological phenomena are affected by causal factors. And those factors are going to vary in magnitude. And in some cases, those factors are going to be unidentifiable, which leads to all of that natural variation, all of that uncertainty. And with that uncertainty, we can start to quantify them and control for them along with the events that are predictable or that we know will actually happen. All right, questions? Know history, look over the definitions, all right, kind of know the terms, know what natural variation is, you know what statistics is and so forth. And that's our intro lecture. All right? Now, ready to go on? All right. And these presentations are posted. So, you can download them. Let's move that. All right. Now what we're going to do is introduction to R. So we're going to work with R. And as I said, we'll kind of, as we get to variables, it's a lot more just lectured, go over terminology. Once we start calculating averages and so forth, we'll get back to R. But this is what we're going to use. All right, so what is R? It's an open source statistics program that's available for Windows, Mac, and Linux. All right, open source basically means it's free. So it's a free program. It actually originated as a free alternative to the S statistics language. S, I think, is now owned by IBM. That used to be pretty powerful. S was an alternative to SAS, which was also... SAS, I believe, was initially owned by IBM, and then IBM started buying up all these stats programs. But S was used in the ecological fields, and then people said, well, I don't want to pay $1,000 a year just to run this program. So then people said, well, we can make our own stuff. And they called it R off the play of S. So that's how they came up with the name. Nice thing is that it's a modular statistics program. You only need to load what you're going to use. And that's pretty advantageous. Right? If you start up like SPSS, you have to load the entire program into memory, including things that you might not use or might never use. R is not that case. All right? We load the base program that has basically all the calculations, you know, means, variances, and so forth. But then if we want to run a specialized test, we have to load that into memory. All right? And it's great. By doing that, it's going to save memory, it's going to save on CPU resources, which makes the program fast. When we load a package, we're going to load it by this command, and I'll show you some other ways, and this is, I include some of these functions as we progress, but we'll do this a lot, you'll know it. The one downside to R is that it's command line driven. You actually have to type the commands to tell R what to do. So our learning curve is actually rather steep. But for the most part, the commands are intuitive. So if you want to calculate the average is a mean, the function is mean. If you want to do the standard deviation, the function is SD. All right, if you want to run a t-test, it's t.test. All right, so for the most part, the commands are intuitive. It's just figuring out how to actually write it. That's the hard part. There are some graphical user interfaces that are developing, and they are maturing. I looked at one that was PSPP. So I mentioned SPSS. This is another alternative, PSPP, that links to R. That's not quite ready. It's actually quite a long ways off. But they do have some other ones. R Commander is one. That we used for one semester. And it makes it easy because you don't necessarily need to know the commands. It's just open up the menu and say, I want to run a t-test. And then it'll ask you, okay, what variable is the grouping variable? And you click it. And say, what's the measurement variable? And you click it. And you hit run. And that works. I think for a class like this, it works. But this class serves as a prereq for the graduate stats class. And by the time we get into those graduate analyses, these graphical user interfaces no longer apply. We have to go back to doing the command line. So it's just kind of one of those things. If you're going to learn the command line to do like a graduate project, might as well just learn it from the start. The last thing, since this is free, a lot of companies, a lot of government organizations use it. So if you're interested in working for Fish and Wildlife, if you're looking interested in working for conservation programs, and you come in and say, yeah, I've learned how to use R in my stats class, I'm at least comfortable working with it, that gives you a leg up on the candidates that are like, no, I need to use SPSS or I need to use JMV and so forth. So there is benefits to learning R. How do we get it? Get it right here. Or you type in Google R statistics and it'll take you here. All right, so rproject.org is the main website. And then when you click download, you pick a mirror and you can pick mirror. I picked the one here in Dallas. That is Revolution Analytics, and it allows you to download. Now, all of us here have the program on the computers here. We don't have to download it. But if you wanted to get it onto your own computer or laptop, yeah, you go to rproject.org, and you click download, and you pick Windows. If you're running Linux, they're in the package managers. If you're on Macs, they also download. But if you're running a Mac, you're going to probably get some errors on a few packages. You'll bring it in. We've encountered them within the last year, so I can help you get the rest of that stuff on a Mac if you have one. All right. So, yeah, R is installed on all of these. I'd say it may be installed on most of the campus computers, but I don't know. I think math and physics, is there a computer lab over there in Vincent? They may have R. They may have R. And just reiterate, if you are installing it and you get errors, email me, and I'll help you. All right. Now, R, put this up. Let me open up R. This is R. This is it. It's just a console window. Type our commands here, and it runs it. All right? I could do help start, right? And it'll open up the help page in a browser. Right. If we wanted to, I can do a script, which is basically a notepad document where I can write my commands here to load a package, and then I can run the line and it pastes it over. All right. This is how I learned this was comfortable. Downside is there's nothing here that's like open data file. So you have to, in order to load a data file, you actually have to know the location on the drive, and you have to give the location using, you know, specifying the hard drive and then the various folders. And it's, I know, you've probably never done that. This is where RStudio comes into play, all right? So R is the stats engine. RStudio is the front end for it. So it basically took R, loads it up and starts porting the Windows into one window, the RStudio environment, and gets it all into a single interface. So we've got our console, or we've got our script window, we've got a list of where all of our packages are, we can have a frame for any figures that we make and so forth. A lot of different things. All right? You can download it and install it from rstudio.com. So if you're installing it on a laptop, or on your own computer, you download RStudio. You download the free desktop version. Now, why do we use it for these things? Importing data files is now point and click. We're going to open data file. It picks up the browser window, right? And you can click through your folders. Real easy. Something that you're probably used to doing. Installing packages becomes a breeze. We hit install package, and we start typing the name. Autocomplete works great. Loading packages, that function library, and then the package name, yeah, that's the function. Or we can see a window of all packages that are installed. All we have to do is hit the checkbox and say, yep, load this one into memory. Looking at variables, functions, histories, etc., it keeps a log of what's in memory and a log of the functions that we've already run. So if we happen to screw up, get error, and it's like, you know, I'm getting errors now, I don't know what I did, you can scroll back and see how it worked the last time it ran. And the new one that we're doing is that we can make an annotated statistical document called an R markdown document. So we have statistical parts that are called chunks. It runs the code in those chunks, and then outside of it, we add our own commentary. This makes it super easy to make really nice formatted documents, and we're going to do that. So RStudio should be installed on all of the computers that I think we checked. If you sit down on one of these computers and it's not installed, let me know. I'll contact IT to get them to install it. If you're using your own laptop or a computer, please install RStudio, because that's what we'll use. So you can go ahead and open up RStudio. And what I'm going to do is we're going to kind of step you through all the different parts of RStudio so you can kind of become familiar with it. Got them up? Looks like it. All right, so make sure I should start mine. All right, so the images that I have, this is on my office computer, which will be slightly different. Yours probably looks something like this, all right? Yours looks something like this. All right, so we are missing the script window. So what you would do is do new file R script, and that'll give us our top left box. This will also be where our markdown document resides, in that top corner. Now, this is my document here. If you're working on your own computer, you can modify some stuff. So, global, and under Tools Global Options, under Appearance, this is where I started changing. I got my dark themes, various different themes that you can use. So, just because I might have a dark theme on it doesn't mean you have to use a dark theme. This is just barely out. So, some people have asked, how do you do that? That's how you do it. So, let me give you an overview. We get four windows in this RStudio. So, this is the entire thing's RStudio. We have the console window. When I started R, that was the console that opened up. Here's the code. This is where we type the command, we run it, and we get the output there. This is a script window. This is basically a text document. That's all it is. Just, you know, Notepad or WordPad. We type the code in here, and then when we select the code and we run it, what it does is copies that and pastes it down in the console, runs it. Up here, we have our environment and history window. Top right. That's going to show us things like what's in memory? What variables do we have in memory? What's the data set that we have in memory? We also have the history tab. You click on the history, it shows the list of all the last functions that were run. And then down here, we have the plots, packages, help window. Quite a few things. File Explorer down there. We typically utilize the packages or the help file or the help windows. You can move them. So I've zoomed in on mine a little bit. I can move this over. I can widen it up. I can change it. Just kind of all depends. You'll see me move it different ways, you know, increase, decrease, and so forth. So, console and the script. So the console window, that has our command prompt. So this is where the commands get typed and you run it. That console window is R itself. So just as an example, go down to your console window at bottom here, and then just right at the line type 4 plus 4 and hit enter. Does it give you an answer? Should. It's a calculator. R is a powerful calculator. R is a powerful calculator. So that works. Now, the script window is a basic text file. The script window is great because we can save it. And then when we open it back up, we can run all those commands still in that script window. And we're going to do those with the markdown files. Nice thing about the script window is that it's able to pass the functions directly to the console, so we don't have to like highlight and paste it itself. There's shortcuts that allow us to do that. All right. So the shortcuts is to say basically highlight it and then click run. Or we can leave it on the line and click run. Or we can leave our cursor on the line and hit Control Enter, which is the shortcut that I do, and it executes that line. So we did 4 plus 4. Here's an example of 5 plus 5 in the script. All right, so 5 plus 5. My cursor is on that line, and this run right here is run item or run the line or the selection. All right, so I didn't highlight anything. Cursors are on the line. I want to run that. When I click run, it's going to copy that code down into our console window and execute it. All right, I can highlight it and click run. It does the same thing. Or with the cursor on the line, I hold control and then I press enter, does the same thing. Multiple ways to do this, but again, copy and paste. All right, so it's essentially shortcuts are copy and pasting. The R markdown, as I'll introduce it, it's a little bit different. It kind of merges. The console is part of the actual text window itself. You'll see it's actually pretty cool. All right, these other two windows, environment history window, you know, just quickly, the environment lists the objects that are currently in memory. We're going to see it. We're going to work through them. We're going to check to make sure things appear as they should appear. All right, it's going to be all of these objects, so data frames, vectors, single values, so single variables. If we create a function, it'll be there. Basically, any object that gets created. History, that's what it is. List the commands. Now, if we open this up and we have a bunch of stuff here and we want to start fresh, all that we have to do is click. Oops. If this is loaded and has a bunch of stuff that we worked on last class and you want to start fresh, all you have to do is click this. Clear objects from the workspace and it cuts it out. Now, as we see, I'm going to tell you don't save anything today because we're not going to get to any of that material. But one of the things, when you try to close R, it'll ask you if it wants to save your session. And when it says you want to save your session, it basically, do you want to save a snapshot of where you're at today? Because then and when you open it tomorrow, it automatically loads it. That includes all of the data frames, all of the objects that were created, and that could be problematic. Especially if we start a new section, a new PowerPoint, and I reuse the variables. Reuse different variables could be problematic. So anytime it asks me if I want to save my history, I just always say no. Don't save it. I always want to start fresh. And you can say, well, why? Why would I start fresh? Why not save everything? Well, our text file has everything that we need. Oops. Darn shortcuts. The My Documents doesn't work. So I have to search through my shared drive. That's my shared drive. So let me show you. Here's a script. I don't know when I did it. Usually I make the script as I'm lecturing. Or make the document, so I've got one for every year. But I don't need to save it. I didn't need to save the history because I can load this up and I can run it. Get everything. And you can see as I ran through it, you can see all of this populated. So I'm back to where I needed to be. So yeah, when I close this down, I don't want to say that. Say quit session. It's going to ask, do you want to save the workspace image? No, don't save. I don't need it. I want to open up fresh again. So when I open up fresh, you're going to see everything's blank. Except, at least for me, I don't know if this works for you or not. On this computer, it always opens up any of these scripts that were opened before. It's convenient. It on my personal computer, it does the same thing too. So I don't know if it works on these computers. All right. Lower right, packages, graphs. It helps. The graphs, I think it saves the 20 graphs. So as we check assumptions, we'll make some graphs. All right, it'll save the last 20 graphs in memory. So if we wanted to, we can cycle between graphs. And we don't have to keep remaking them. It lists the packages that are currently installed. They might not be loaded in memory, but they're installed. And this is also going to be where they show our help files. All right. Now, what we're going to use are markdown documents. Markdown documents are basically formatted documents. So they're notebooks. They call them notebooks, that will end up weaving narrative text with the code to produce a nicely formatted output. All right? This is included in RStudio, and this was a really nice addition. So our code that we can use is R. That's what we're going to use in the class. But if you're in like computer science or some other class, Python will work, SQL code will work. When we hit our knit document basically says, okay, we're going to take the code parts, we're going to take the narrative parts, we're going to combine them into a nice document, PDF, Word, or HTML. We're going to make ours as a Word that you can then save as a PDF and upload it or print in sense of some of our exams. Now, how do we do that? We start with File, New File, and create our markdown. So go ahead and do that. So it opens up this. We can give it a title. And we're not going to save this one. Right. And what you'll probably do is save it as a Word file. So I've just called it Class 1 Author. Hit OK. And it does, and it makes this. And right now, we're just going to kind of go over the details of it. If you go forward a couple slides, we're going to do different tasks in a markdown document. So I think on Wednesday, we'll create a new markdown document as like an intro to R. And you'll see me how I annotate it with the chunks. And hopefully at the end, you'll have a document that is almost identical to what I have. But the first thing it does is gives this information up at the top. This is basically information that R will use when it knits the document. So it has a title, it has the author, it has a date, and it has an output format. So our output format will be Word document. So when we knit it, it takes everything and puts it all into a Word document that Word will then open up. This part is defined as a chunk. All right, so any chunk that we have is going to be preceded by these marks. These are, the diacritical marks, not quite accent marks. They're like backward accent marks, and I don't know if I have a good name for them. What's a name for those? They're not apostrophes. So, PowerPoint I've got, it's these things. They're not apostrophe. So these are the grave accent mark is what I've heard they've been called. It's the key right next to the one. All right, so you've got your squiggly. You use the shift key to access the squiggly. If you don't have the shift, you get one of these backward accent marks. All right. Three of them in a row with the curly brace sets up the chunk. And this says, I'm going to run an R chunk. So the code is R, all right? It's called setup. And then include equals false says, you know, should I include it in the write-up? And it's like, no, I don't. We don't want to output it. This, we're not going to change. There's a lot of cool things we can do with it if we wanted to, like specifying default figure sizes, altering some font, whatever. There's a lot of cool things we could do in these, but we won't. We're just going to, whenever our markdown starts up or creates the document, we're going to leave this as is. Okay? It knows the chunk is ended because it has three more of these things. All right? So then what we can do is start annotating our document with here. So quick run through. So it'll start annotating the document. So with our documents, the pound signs, hashtags, mark our headings. So in our Word document, you have heading 1, heading 2, heading 3, heading 4 for all of the different styles. Well, the number of pound signs tell us what number of heading it is. So the more pound signs you have, we're going to like heading 4, heading 5, which in theory should be smaller in terms of the heading styles list. So on this one, this is actually probably heading 2. If it was just 1, it'd be heading 1, would be the largest one. And then what you can do is just go ahead and start typing. So note, the line numbers are numbered. We've got the title or the heading R markdown is on line 12. Right? Line 13 is blank. Line 14 is actually this long line. So in a markdown document, this would automatically wrap the text. In a regular script, it does not. So here's that 5+5 one. I copied and pasted it, and it pastes it all in a single line. How hard is it to read? It's really hard, right? Not only that, but 5+5 runs, right? If I run this, I get an error message because it's like, yeah, unknown symbol. I have no idea what to do. Well, in a regular script window, if I want to annotate it, I have to use the pound sign to say, yeah, this isn't code. So now R just skips it. But because of the lack of word wrapping, we have to manually do the breaks and have the hashtag at the end of everything. So before our markdown came out, this is what we had to do. This is how we were instructing it to take annotated scripts. Now with our markdown, we do it this way. So as we'll see moving ahead, as I introduce, let's say, t.test, I explain what the function is doing up here. So you can write it down. You can annotate the documents. So outside of this class, maybe next semester, you're saying, I need to run a t-test. I've done it in R. Let me open up my R markdown document and see how I run it. And then you've got perfect notes for you to guide your new test or guide you as you run those new tests. All right? So we annotate it. Now we have a new chunk. All right? So this was all, I'm sure yours popped up. How do we run the chunk? Well, the chunks now have these play marks. All right? So these buttons will run the entire chunk. So I hit the play button, it runs a chunk, and instead of having to look at the console for the output, our markdown will now put some of the output right below it. So as we run through, as we're going through all of this class, we're going to make chunks, we're going to have the code, we're going to run it, we're going to get the output, and then when we get the output, we can then go down to here and say, and annotate it and say, the average speed was 15.4, the IQR is 12 to 19. So we can annotate. We see the output, and then we can take the notes and do the answers. This will be the format of our take-home or the open book exam, part 2 of the exam. It's an R markdown document with the questions. All right. Here's question 1. I'll say, look at, give me a summary of cars and tell me what the average of speed is. All right. So you would type summary cars, and then in the answer, you'd say the average speed was 15.4. So I can see that you did the code correctly. I know you had the output, and then you answered the question of 15.4. This also works with plots. So it'll put the plot right here. Now, when we knit it, this is the nice thing. It takes that chunks. We have it set up. This case doesn't. It hides that. But it'll show the code, and then it'll show the output right after it, all into one document. So let me see if I can find one. That's R. Let me open up an R markdown document. I don't know what homework assignment this is. But here is one of those documents. It's a regular Word document. I've got my chunks. I've got my code here. I've got all of our output. And I go through and I've annotated it. So I've added, you know, the interpretation of the graphs, the interpretation of everything else, and all of those pound signs. It just ranked different headings. So, you know, that heading is heading one, you know, big style, and then part A is a little bit smaller, and so forth. All right. So we're gonna get used to this. We're gonna use R markdown. You're gonna get comfortable using it. And I'm actually gonna say that as we're taking notes in class, I'm gonna suggest using R markdown. This, as we get to the actual stats part and using R, I'm going to suggest have an R markdown. Take your notes in there. Take your notes on that document because the notes will pair up to the actual code. All right? So what are we going to do? On Wednesday, we'll start this. So what we'll do is we'll start a brand new markdown document. Then I'm going to show you how to create different objects. Create a data point, create a vector, create data frames. I'm going to show you how we can load data frames. So there are data frames that are already built into R, and there's data frames that I will give you. All right, so these are the data that's posted on Blackboard. I'm going to show you how we can reference variables within a data frame so that we don't have to, you know, you have to tell R where every variable is. If R can't find it, it's going to return an error. So I'm going to show you how we can reference specific variables that's found in data frames. And then we're going to actually practice knitting this document when we're done using the Word template file that I have. So that way everyone's Word document should be very, very similar in style formatting. And then after we kind of do this in class, and we're going to do this together, like walking it through, then I'm going to give you some important tips to remember that I know you're going to forget, but it'll just constantly, oh, remember, R is unique. Right, capitalization matters. Spacing usually doesn't matter, but yeah, types of quotations matter. All right, and then once we get through this, then I have part two of this introduction, which is basically practice on your own. You're going to do that here in class. So if you run into errors, I'm here to kind of help you get used to it, because one of the first things we have to learn how to do is import data, because I give you the data that we're going to work with. All right, so it's been about an hour. I'm not going to lecture anymore. I'm sure you're probably getting tired. Man, it's an hour. We'll call it quits. And now this would be a time where if we had a homework assignment posted, and we'll have regular homework. You can use this time to work through the homework. All right, or if you want to leave, you can leave. You want to do other homework for a class? You can. And as I said, if you're in here doing other homework and you're the only one in here, if it's not biostats related, I'll probably just head down to my office. Or in this case, I had to get my daughter to PT in 45 minutes. So I'll stick around until about 3:30 or so down in my office. You guys have any questions? Again, if you get, you're going to hear me say it, if you get errors in R, email me. All right? There's nothing more about something that might drive you to drinking than the errors that R gives you that tend to be uninformative. So I'll help you look at it. And that, I guess I didn't say it, that's also on the exam too. The take-home part, if you get an error and you can't figure out that error, you can email me for help at a point deduction. Right? Some cases, I don't even take the point off because it's like, oh man, you the cat, you know, you look at some of the letters, capital U or capital C versus the lowercase c, it's hard to tell apart on a screen. I say, look, you gotta, that's capital. Just go ahead and fix it. But that way you can continue doing the exam and answer all the questions while avoiding that error. So I'm here to help. All right. You guys are good. This door was closed this morning. We're going to have a schedule of who's in this room. If there's another class in this room, just please don't disturb them. But if there's no class, feel free to come in here. I don't know if there's instructions on how to get in with your ID. I don't know if you can or not. That's what we have. All right? All right. Y'all have a good one.